Claiborn.
And I'm Dr. Hazel Claiborn.
And you are watching the Potter's House of Jesus Christ.
So you've been searching for a long time, searching for some peace of mind. God is the answer, and he hears your prayers. Just come to the Father, he'll be right there. The Potter,
he wants
to make you whole.
Just receive
the word from the Potter's house.
Amen. Did anybody come to have a church on today? Hallelujah. Amen. So we're here to celebrate 17 years. Hallelujah. For everything that God has done. For he's truly been good. I know he's been good to me. Have you been good to anybody else?
That's all right.
come their way. Make no mistake, they did not say, we've had to endure some rain, travel some tough terrain. That goes without saying, trials come to us all and call us by name. But they have kept the faith and they have remained the same. It's always trust God and never doubt. Surely he will bring you out. It has been 17 years since they took God's hand to lead the people of God on to the promised land. Indeed, they are preparing souls for heaven and to live successful lives. Down at the Father's house, we're eating good, gaining strength so we can thrive. V-I-C-T-O-R-Y, victory is our war cry. We speak life, we shall live and not die. For we are living that we may live again. No longer are we participants in sin. No longer do we walk according to the flesh. Our pastor has taught us this. Be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Resist the enemy and he will take flight. Faith equals success. So go ahead and walk on water. Take the limits off God. Let him operate without borders. And First Lady Dr. Claiborn teaches her daughters not to waver. It's on the word of God that you can stand. You have dunamis power through the Holy Ghost to command. So speak those things that are not as though they were. Nobody goes harder for Jesus than her. So Senior Pastor Earnest Claiborn and First Lady Dr. Hazel Claiborn, the Potter's House of Jesus Christ celebrates you both. You're number one in our book and you'll always have our vote. You're the best of the best, hands down, no contest. You're the best pastor and first lady around town. You preach the unadulterated gospel, doctrine that is sound. You lead with distinction, so we willingly follow you. As you walk in victory, we do too. V-I-C-T-O-R-Y, Potter's House of Jesus Christ, let me hear your war cry.
People doubting, but I gotta keep looking up. said I wouldn't be here today. They said I'd never amount to anything.
Started out water ahead of me. Acts chapter number 6, beginning at verse number 1 through 4, if you're able to stand, if you will stand in honor of the word of God. And in those days, when the number of the disciples were multiplied, there arose a murmuring of the Grecians against the Hebrews, because their widows were neglected in the daily ministration. Then the 12 called the multitude of the disciples unto them and said, it is not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you 7 men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. You may be seated. We've already prayed over the word of God. I want to read into your hearing once again, verse number 2, and then I'll give you the subject that the Lord has given me for today. Then the 12 called the multitude of the disciples unto them and said, it is not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. The message that God has given me today is entitled, Know Your Role in the Church. Know Your Role in the Church. The thing I like about these kind of services, when you have an anniversary or a few other special occasion services, many times, such as today, you won't get your traditional sermon message, but you're going to get what you need in the Word. Know your role in the church. I'm very sure that every one of us already know that the most important role in the church under God is the pastor, who God had placed as his under-shepherd to lead and guide his sheep, which are the people of God. But as pastors, if we're not careful, it is very easy to get too caught up in other things, or with other things. And it's easy, it can become easy for us to step out of our role and step into another role that God did not place over us. Probably the most common mistake that most pastors make in stepping out of our role usually involved the mistake that was avoided in Acts chapter number 6. And this is when we leave the word of God to serve in other capacities or other areas that we should in his or her capacity. If not, then something gets out of place, and then one part have to compensate for the other part, and then there is some schism and there's some problem because somebody's out of place and somebody not in their proper place, so the body has some issues now. For instance, even in our natural body, if our kidneys stop functioning properly, then it causes usually the liver to start trying to make up the difference. The liver starts, which is used to secrete our bowel out of our bodies, the waste part of our bodies, the things we don't need. But the kidney is supposed to be the one that flushes it on down to that particular organ and then carry out the rest of the process. But if it's not functioning properly, then the liver has to work even harder to perform its task, and then things are still out of whack, it's just out of order, because every part needs to do their function or do perform their task in order for the body to function properly. The same way it is in the church. Now, early on, it is already commonly known that most pastors, if you start a church from scratch that is not already developed, that means you started a church that have not already been in operation, just as we did here. Everybody knows when you start that way, many times the pastor have to wear other hats until enough people come into the church, just as it was 17 years ago when we started. So then there comes that particular time where many different tasks that the pastor shouldn't be performing have to perform because we didn't have the right number of people to perform those tasks. So you have to wear many hats. That is understandable. But nevertheless, it still is a over-functioning in the pastoral ranks, and therefore some things has to be left undone or not properly done, because if you do too many tasks at the same time or too often, then you're leaving some tasks undone. So then you do what you can to make it work, but things are not operating at full capacity as it should. But when you're in your growing process, that is necessary many times. So we knew early on, starting out, that it was going to be that way until God sent others that would be able to operate in these various tasks and areas so that the body can become complete and be what God called for us to be as a body of church, a church body, a body of believers. So then we have to do multiple tasks that we shouldn't be doing in order to keep everything moving forward, albeit it's not at the place where God wanted to be, but still working, and God will make up the difference in due time. So we have to sometimes, in the beginning stages, do some things that we know are outside of our role as pastors. But after time takes place and God began to send people to the church that can operate in these other capacities, ushers and the choir directors and the musicians and Bible school teachers and the ministerial staff to fill out the deacon board and the mother's board and the cleaning staff and all of these other areas that needs to be manned or womaned by people in the church. Once everyone comes and God starts filling these positions, then the body can begin to operate at its full capacity, because now we're not overloading one part of the body that is performing multiple tasks or multiple roles that part should be performing, but everyone now have lined up and they're doing their own, they're performing all of their own roles. So now the body begins to function more efficiently and properly according to the will of God. And we're talking about the church, the body of Christ. So then that's what happens in the beginning stages, but afterwards it's time to get in our right places as God filled these roles in the church, so now everyone can operate in their own place. And so what happened is with most pastors, we tend to, after God sends the people, sometimes we get so used to being in certain additional roles that we still try to hang on to some of these roles, and God have to put us back in line and place and say, you got your own role now, it's time to let that go and let someone else handle that part, because it was not yours in the beginning, but it was necessary until someone came and filled that role. But God has sent someone, so now we have to let go and let someone handle that role. And so many pastors, I've talked to many of my pastoral friends, and we all seem to have similar testimonies, especially those of us that started churches from scratch. And that is, We continually to do things we should have done even after God filled the position with other people. And one of the big mistakes in that area that I know God had to correct me on, I made this mistake for years and years. Matter of fact, probably up to the last 2 years. And God had to correct me on that, and that was continually leaving the word and going doing other things, and particularly picking up people. When God said, I want you to concentrate on your duty, we got other folks to do that. And thank God that the Lord pressed upon the hearts of some of the saints quite a few years ago to say, Pastor, we're going to start picking up people for church. We don't want you doing that. And you see, mature saints of God know that because they've been around and they know what God is saying. When you have a relationship with God, you understand the order of the church. But because I was the van driver when I came here from my old church, being there 15 years with my pastor, so I just got used to picking up people. And when I came here, it was business as usual. But when you get in a different role, God wants you to focus on that role you're in, and especially as a pastor, because our role carries many different hats anyway. Because there's many things we have to be a physician, so to speak, to many people in the spiritual realm. We have to be a counselor. We have to be one that's there to a chaplain, so to speak, to go to perform hospital duties. And we have to go and solve issues and problems. And we have to give advice. And we have to do many different other things. So the last thing we need is other things that take us away from the word of God. So then God began to tell me, he said, now, I've been telling you over and over to let that go. Because you already have been told that there are people in the church that say, Pastor, we're going to pick up the saints that need to be picked up. Don't worry about it. But I continually were doing it, even though they were telling me that, because I was so used to it. And then I remember a few times that I ministered right here in the pulpit, and God just shut down on me. And I'm still, because I've been preaching so long, over 25 years, I can continue to go with things, but God was, I remember a few Sundays I picked up people and God was just wearing me out the whole time we're riding. Didn't I tell you to stop this? Didn't I tell you that that's not your role? You need to be working on the word. You need to be meditating. And God would stop giving me things for the message on Sunday and just shut me down. And I had to come here knowing what's going on in the spirit realm and like, and finish the message. But some things that I would have gotten, I didn't get. Some things I could have gotten and would have gotten from God to help you, I didn't get it because God was teaching me a lesson. So when the pastor overextends and get into other roles, the problem is it trickles down and it hurts you. Not only us, but it hurts the people. Because I can remember vividly some of those Sundays when the Lord just shut down and said, you know what? I'm not going to give you extra. I would have given you some other things to help the people, but you won't listen. And so I finally had to get to the place because I was so used to picking up people, and it was just something I guess I enjoyed doing from back home. But now that I'm in a different role, I have to be mindful of the word of God. And this in chapter 6 of Acts, where we're going to now, you're going to find out why this is necessary and what God dealt with the apostles on, because in this day and time, the apostles, because they were apostles, the disciples of Jesus that were alive, minus Judas, of course, they were the ones that were establishing churches. They were the ones that, when they established churches, they were the pastors over these churches until they found an elder to place in that particular church. And they became the overseer, which apostles do. Apostles they are the founders of churches, and then they place pastors over those churches, but they remain the overseer. And when the pastors have problems and issues, then they look to the apostle, which is the overseer, and he comes in and straightens the problems out. That's why you hear throughout Corinthians, Paul is straightening out so many problems with the Corinthian church because he was the overseer. He was not the pastor, but he had passed that duty on to someone that was eligible to do it. And someone that the Lord told him in the spirit to anoint to be the pastor. But at this time, at this particular time, the apostles were the ministers of the gospel of the word in the churches at this time. And so they had the responsibility of feeding the people. That's why it's important to understand how our role is important, that we stay in our role. And I'll give you this analogy that the Lord gave me to give me even extra clarity of why it's important. He said this, he said, now think about a cook, because when we think about receiving the word of God, we're talking about eating spiritually. The word of God feeds us. He said, now think about a cook in the kitchen. If you're in the kitchen and you're beginning to prepare the meal, maybe you have pasta boiling in a pot, maybe you have cornbread in the oven, maybe you have some kind of food, some kind of meat in the skillet, and all these things are going at the same time. And all of a sudden, in the midst of preparing your meal, you leave the pot on, you leave the oven on, you leave the skillet on, and you decide to go and clean the bathroom. You stop cooking and go and start, scrubbing out the tub. Then you start getting and scrubbing out the toilet while the food is still cooking by itself. It's not being monitored. It's not finishing being prepared. You may not have put the right seasoning in. You need to adjust the heat. Maybe it's too hot. So you left the food cooking and we're in the bathroom when somebody else should be doing that. Your job is to be cooking, not to be in the bathroom. Cleaning the toilets and cleaning out the bathtub and changing out the towels, because that means you've left the food alone, unattended. And so finally, when you finish cleaning up the bathroom and you get back to the word, to the food, it may be burnt. Or if you had the mindset to turn it off before you left to go in the bathroom, it's cold now. You didn't test it to see about the seasoning. It may not be the right seasoning now. So it's not going to meet the needs. And maybe you were in so big of a hurry that you did not make sure you met all the food groups. You don't have enough, you don't have any carbohydrates. Maybe you have not enough protein. Maybe you just have, maybe you left off the fruits and vegetables. And maybe maybe you're loaded with dairy products. Maybe you have a lot of cheese and a lot of milk. But you didn't have a balanced meal because you didn't take the time to make sure you had the right servings of protein and carbohydrates and fruits and vegetables and dairy products. You need all of these combined with the right portion size to make a complete meal, but you were so distracted by trying to make sure the bathroom clean, you left the food unattended, and now when you serve it, we can't eat it. Or if we eat it, it might make us sick. Or we just may not even, it may not meet the need. We may not get enough protein, so we're weak. We don't have enough energy to continue our day. So spiritually, the Lord said, this is what happened when pastors get out of their role doing other things. You leaving the word unattended, and now when the people need to be fed because you got to go through your week, and God knows the tasks that are ahead of us. He knows the trials and the oppositions and everything we're going to go through that week. So what God does, he began to prepare you at the first day of the week. That's why we come to church on Sundays. So you can get full of everything you need spiritually. So when the enemy comes your way, you're powerful in the Lord and you're ready to just tear down his kingdom and you're ready to rebuke him. You're ready to walk all over him because God gave you what you need to power you throughout that day when it's done right. But if I served you because of my too busyness, if I served you a snack when you needed a meal, then you're going to be lacking throughout that week.
That's right.
And somewhere down the line, you just might get weak. Because when we disconnect from God, that's when problems begin to happen. But it happens so much in the church because pastors are trying to do our part, but sometimes we do too much. And then we allow ourselves to get called away from the word, which is the most important part of the church.
Yeah.
Because it is the word of God that saves us. It is the word of God that feeds us spiritually. And without the word of God, we can't make it. But what about if you don't get the word you need? Then you end up going through a week of weakness spiritually. So here in this text, the Bible says, in those days, when the number of disciples were multiplied, There arose a murmuring of the Grecians against the Hebrews because their widows were neglected in the daily ministrations. Now, this is we know that it is important for, in that day and time, it was important for the widows to be taken care of. Because in that day and time, they did not have social services like we have. They did not have welfare, and they did not have social security and all these other government programs that our widows today can get compensations from. So what happened in this day, in biblical time, the church were, in essence, the social services. So when, and women didn't work in that day and time. The husband worked, and the wives stayed home, and they took care of the house. So if the husband died, then what happens to the wife? She don't have any work history. She's not used to working. Women didn't work in that day outside the home. And so the widows would end up being in need. So because they did not have social services, the churches was there to be the umbrella for the widows. And so their job was when the husband died, the church would just take up the responsibility to make sure all the widows and their children, if they had them, were properly fed. At this day and time, the Greeks began to complain because they said the Hebrews are not giving our widows the same compensations of food. They're neglecting our widows, and they're just making sure their widows get extra because they're Hebrews just like they are. And so this confusion arose among the saints. You're not feeding our people like you feed your own people, even though they all was in the church, but some of them were Greek and some of them were Hebrews, and the Greeks said that you're not doing our women the same way. You're not giving them the same treatment. And so anytime matters came that the pastors could not handle, of course, it would fall on the responsibility of the apostles who were the overseers at this particular time. And so they began to convene together, Peter and the apostles, and they began to look at the problem at hand, but they had to honor the will of God by letting the people know that this is an important matter. Other chores in the church that pastors do are important because they need to be done. In the early years, we used to also have to put all the equipment up. We didn't leave things up like we do now. A lot of the sound system and everything is left up. We used to have to put everything up. And in those first early years, me and my three sons, they were in the church, and my oldest daughter, she was in the church. We used to have, what kind of car was that? That little Nissan Sentra. We have four kids, so it was six of us, and then her sister, your sister was here the first year. Seven people in that little bitty Nissan Sentra. And our trunk would be full coming from Lakeville because we put all the equipment in our trunks. You all remember the electronic drums? Who remember the electronic drums? You've been here a long time, you remember that. Even though that electronic drum pad. And all the sound system. Our trunk would be loaded, and we would transport Lakeville and back every service. And we'd get here early, me and my boys and a few other saints. We would be, Brother Darrell, he was in the church in that time, those early years. Thank God for Brother Darrell. Amen. He was here, and Brother D and the Elder Lamar, and everybody was a lot younger. But we had a few of us here, And we would bring all that stuff, and we'd get here early, and I remember we had to get here probably close to an hour early. We set everything up. And I remember sometimes after lifting all those stuff, I would be so tired, but I wouldn't say anything. I'm like, man, I'm almost too tired to preach. Just worn out. That's all. Then at the end of service, we had to do the same thing back, take everything back up. Oh, boy, that was transporting every service back and forth, Fridays and Sundays, and we had Wednesday Bible class upstairs at that time. But all of these extra duties, and it wears on you, but at the time, you're in a mentality that it needs to be done, so I'm not thinking on it. But it has a bearing on you, whether you notice it or not, and then afterwards, when you stand away from it, and you see what happens when you can fully focus on God and keep your attention on God, then you see the difference. Because one thing about pastoring, it is important that we stay in a spiritual state with God consistently. That is important. Other ministers don't really have to do that all the time, but it's important as much as they can to do it, but it's imperative for pastors. Because the more we stay before God,
the more God gives to us, because needs are always changing in what's going on with the people, because as a pastor, you are watching for the souls of the people. So your souls are on our plate of responsibilities. Whereas if I'm a minister, or evangelist, or under the pastor, that's not my responsibility when I'm not the pastor. And I've been in that role for years before I became the pastor. So I didn't have that burden, but as the pastor, all of those responsibilities of people's soul is on us. So the more we stay before God, then the more we're able to know the heart and mind of God, and He tells us what the needs of the people are. And if we disconnect from that, or we get too caught up in other things, then you're missing so much. Those first 2 years that I was pastoring and working at Wells Fargo, I missed so much and I knew it. I got a pastor friend back home, and I hope he finally has quit working. I hadn't made contact with him in a few years. We've been missing one another, but his wife was begging him, you gotta stop. And he was saying, man, I don't have time to study like I need to because this job taking up all my time. And that is the truth. If you're working, if a pastor's working a full-time job, well, he's a part-time pastor. And that means your soul is being manned part-time. And that's the dangers of it. And when the Lord stopped me from doing that job and just focus on here, I saw the difference. I'm like, oh my God, was I missing that much? I mean, it's like going from half full to full.
All right.
And I'm saying, and I remember thinking, how did the saints even make it? Man, you were getting snacks and didn't even know it. You've been half fed because you can only be permanent or full time in one place. You can say I'm working two full-time jobs, but in essence you're working two half jobs. What you're giving a job, because you can only be permanent or full-time doing one particular thing. Because if you split that, even though you may be using those full, you may be working full-time hours, but if you split your attention, then you can only give a portion of yourself to whatever you're doing, unless you're focusing on one thing. And so that's the dangers of it, because the people end up lacking. And I don't know about you, I'm not putting nothing over my soul. Our soul is the most important thing we have. Above everything, our soul is the most important. And that's the thing that we have to keep in mind. So getting back to our text, so the 12 called the multitude of the disciples together, and they said to them, it is not reason that we should leave the word and serve tables. We don't need to stop preparing the food and go and clean out the living room or the kitchen or the bathroom, but we need to keep our attention on the word. Because one thing that happens, don't you know, the devil wants pastors to be distracted. He wants us to spread to the end. Because he sits back and laughs and says, I know you're missing things now because you ain't connecting like you ought to be with God because you're too busy. There could be time with God. So he loved that. And that's why as pastors we have to be wise. And actually, I don't remember the last time I actually picked somebody up. It's been such a long time. But the thing is, the disciples got it right away. Because just think about it, this was a need. All the people are saying, we need some help. We need you all to do something about it. Our widows are hungry and the Hebrew widows are being fed. What are you going to do? And the apostles had to remember their role. They had to remember that God placed them first and foremost to be over the word of God. They had to remember that this is not the right method for us to take. We can't allow ourselves to leave the word and go and start serving tables. I understand they need to be fed, but we have to come up with something else. We can't allow ourselves to get away from praying and fasting and preparing, because in order to preach, you have to pray. You have to spend time with God. You have to study the word. You have to meditate on the word. You have to soak in the word so God can give you the extras that come with that word. In every one, in every chapter and verse in the Bible, there's the word of God. But there's also messages that speaks to every individual from that word. But for the man or woman of God to know what it is, you have to spend time with God. And God give you that particular message from that word for this individual. That's how so many times you say, oh, the pastor was preaching totally to me. No, I wasn't. That was God preaching totally to you. He was just using my mouth. Because I don't know anything without God. God is the one that knows everything. And if we're, and as long as we stay connected to God, he gives it to us. But if we get out of our role and start getting into other roles, then God begin to disconnect, or we disconnect, and then we begin to miss some things from God. So then the apostle said, we can't handle, we can't do that, because it is not reason for us to leave the word of God and begin to serve tables. So they said, wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you. In other words, they said, we need to delegate this thing, because that's what God wants in the church. There have to be a delegation of responsibilities, because one person can't do everything, and we shouldn't allow one person to do everything, because we all have our responsibility. We all have roles in the kingdom. We all have roles in the church, and we should want to be participators and not spectators. And so then they said, look ye out among yourself, the brethren, that is, and find 7 men of good report. And they said, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. Now notice here, many times when people look at responsibilities in the church, if they do not carry what we call prestigious or a responsibility that is in front of the mic or in the podium or behind the podium or in the pulpit or somewhere up front, many times we look at these responsibilities as not being as important. But notice here what the apostles did. They were trying to get men that would be over serving the widows food. They were not trying to get people to lead the worship service. They were not trying to get people to be over the prayer service. They were not trying to get people to be over the musicians. But they said people to serve food. But even these responsibilities in the kingdom, we don't usually take much thought into putting the right people over it. But the apostle let us know how important everything in the church is, because he said, look, they said, look among you and find 7 men of good report. Don't just get the brothers that ain't doing nothing in the church that's just laying in the back. We just let them serve. But they said, this business is so important, we won't save men. We want some men that love God. They can get 7 men of good report, full of the Holy Ghost and full of wisdom. We want men that full of faith. We want men that love God to serve tables. You know, we think that anybody can serve table. Hey, get that little brother over here. Get that little sister. No. They said, when it comes to God, people, we want the best. I know it's serving meals, but we want some folks that are so connected to God that they're going to make sure when they serve a meal, it's going to be the right kind of meal. Somebody that's going to make sure that everything is ran and in order and in line. So every part of the church is important. You know, a lot of times people think about when it comes to cleaning up the church, that we don't need people that love God or the strong saints, so to speak. But yes, we do. We need the strong saints to clean up the church. We need the strong saints to do whatever chores that need to be done. We don't just get those that are in the corner. Of course, they can help. But God wants all of us, whatever our role is, to be a part of the kingdom. And so we get the best of those. And even when my wife and I was at home with our pastor, we cleaned the church. We used to clean the bathrooms out. We used to clean the toilets. We used to do the work. I used to come and mow the church grass. You know, and I remember one time my car was out of working condition. You know what I did? Should I skip the church line? You know what I did? I walked 4 miles. Mowed the grass. I could have called the pastor and he would have been glad to pick me up, because this was not a church day. But I wasn't going to do that. I walked all the way to the church. It was about, I estimated about 4 miles from our home to the church, because the church was in the city and we stayed out in the county. Okay. So about 4 miles, I walked to church after I got off work, because I used to work overnight at the prison. Yeah. And I got a little sleep, maybe about 4 or 5 hours from that morning to, I don't know, maybe 12 or 1. I walked 4 miles to the church, mowed all the church lawn, made sure the inside was clean, and walked back home. That's making sure you do what needs to be done. Didn't call nobody, I guarantee to this day, my pastor still has no idea. And I called him yesterday, his birthday was yesterday, he turned 73. But anyway, I guarantee he still don't know. He knew I used to go to church, but he don't know those circumstances, how I got there. Because when something needs to be done, you do it. That's the way I believe it.
That's right.
You just do it. It doesn't matter. I was an elder, but I did it. You think I let a title stop me from working for God? Are you kidding me? He couldn't stop me from grabbing the man. My pastor, after some years, he said, son, we got deacons in the church. You done been promoted from there. I said, Dad, I love doing it. I still do it. Because some of them was griping about doing it. And my mother did it for years before I got old enough to do it. My mother used to drive the van. And I said, when I got old enough to drive at 18, I said, I'm taking that responsibility from my mother. And I did. Because we had men in the church, big grown men, that could have been driving the van because I was a teenager at that time. I couldn't drive. We had grown men in the church. A lot older than me. I was a teenager, so I couldn't drive. They wouldn't let me. I did get my license at age 16, but of course, insurance company went on letting me drive at that young age. And I said, when I got old enough to drive, I'm going to take over that responsibility. We had grown brothers in the church that should have been driving the van. That's a shame a sister have to drive the van when we got men in the church. Now that's knowing your role. Some things should be for men to do. You know, we ought to know the difference. This was back home, not in our church, but this was back home. But as a young child, I saw that. So getting back here, the apostle said, now, we're not going to do this responsibility ourselves because there's not reason for us to leave the word. But we're going to look out and we're going to find seven men of faith, full of the Holy Ghost, full of wisdom, that love God, and we're going to appoint them over this business and let them handle it. And they said, but what we're going to give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. You see, it's important to understand that when you're carrying the word of God, as pastors do, that's why as pastors we have to know our role. Because it's important to stay prayed up. Because the thing about prayer is the very thing that gets us into the mind of God. We have the word that tells us how God is and what he does and what he desires from us and who he is, but it takes prayer to unite us in the presence of God and become spiritually one with God in high places. It comes through communing with him in prayer. And so anytime you're going to have anybody that carries the word of God, they better be a prayer warrior. You better be someone that knows how to spend time with God, because just knowing the scriptures is not enough. I know many people who know the scripture, but they don't know how to apply the scripture. They don't know the deeper meanings of the scriptures. You got inmates that learn by being locked up how to pronounce and quote scriptures, but they have no understanding of the word. You see, it's not impressive that a person can quote the scripture, but can you define and live the scripture? Can you explain it to make it simple to a child that they can understand it? You see, that's what the Bible means about rightly dividing the word. You see, when it comes to being a mature saint of God, and especially a pastor or someone that carries the word, we have to make sure that we have our spiritual maintenance in line and in order, that we are spiritually prepared. And in order to be spiritually prepared, we have to do like the apostles said. We cannot get away from the word of God. And we have to make sure that we are continually in prayer, because we need to know when the winds of spiritual winds change, that God is trying to send us that information, what's going on in the body of Christ. You see, as pastors, we need to know the pulse of the church. We need to know what's going on in areas that God needs need us to minister to, because the enemy is always trying to disguise himself. He's always trying to destroy some things and people in general. But when you are connected to God as the man or woman of God, then we know our role, because in order to be connected with God, we have to do what it takes to stay in the presence of God. And then once we do our part, God begin to minister to us, and we can carry our role out as the man or woman of God. I've come to share a message with you from the Lord. They're telling us to know our role. If you are the musician, and God has musicians, and God have anointed your hands, then God expect you to minister the word in music, that is. But see, here's the thing. Notice here, when they got ready to appoint men to go and serve meals, they made sure they got men whose life was right with God. Because if you're going to minister to the saints in any capacity, we need some Holy Ghost saved folks. We can't just let anybody come and get in the role because you desire to be there. But if the apostles would make sure that even to serve tables, you got to have the Holy Ghost. And notice they said a good report. You see, some people are in church, but they got a bad reputation outside the church. Sometimes you find out you can be coming to church faithfully, but you're putting all kind of filth online, doing stuff on Facebook, and people see all your business, and it's stuff that is a shame that you should be associated with. Some people are at church and showing the world just how carnal they are, showing the world just how sinful their activities are. Sometimes people in the church, I've been told, because I don't deal with social media, I've been told they've seen people drunk in the church online because they put it out there. You see, the devil want to make a fool out of you. He wants you to embarrass yourself. And so you spread all of your godliness online. Some of you have been high and posted pictures online. Shame on you. Number one, for being a sinner and then acting like you don't care. At least repent, get it right, and stop letting the devil use you. Stop letting the devil make a fool out of you to show the world how ungodly you can be. But God wants you to take serious your life and said, I'm tired of being used up by the devil. I'm tired of the devil making a fool out of me. You may get a few laughs online, but you got to understand that your soul is required of you. Every one of us have a responsibility to make sure that how we live line up with God's word. I don't know about you, but nothing is more important to me than my name and reputation in the Lord. Nothing is more important to me than being saved, sanctified, but not just with my lips, but with my actions. How I walk, how I talk, how I speak, how I live. That's what's most important. I heard the Bible say in Proverbs that even a great name is more to be desired than rubies. Your name and your reputation should be important to you. I would love for people to be able to look back and say that you were saved and holy, and their remembrance of you is that you love the Lord. So it's time to come out of being in sin. Come out and know your role in the church, but you can't operate in the church if you're still living in the world. But God got a place for you in the kingdom. So come out of sin. Come out of living like the devil. Come out of living like the world. God wants you to be holy in the morning. Holy on your own. You can't teach Bible class and you're still living like sinners live. Can't do that. You can't be over ministries and you still out there drinking, smoking, living like the world. No, you got to get saved and let God. He may have that role for you, but you can't operate in that role until you get cleaned up. You may be out there fighting, cursing, and then you come to church and want to be in charge. You can't do that. No, that doesn't work like that. On Saturday night, you out brawling with folks, cursing everybody out you can find, going home cursing your family out, acting like you King Kong or somebody. And then you come here, no, you know nobody. You need more of your sheep. We loaning you that sheep for a moment. Because it's important, if we're going to operate in our role, we have to live it. You got to live it.
So you've been searching for a long time, searching for some peace of mind. God is the answer, and he hears your prayers. Just come to the Father, he'll be right there. The Potter.